Please stand if you're able and join us in our opening message.
Coming up next weekend, the Buddy Walk, which is sponsored by the Down Syndrome Alliance, and our own Vanessa Chamberlain is a leader in that organization. That's happening in Fletcher on Saturday, so if you're interested in participating and supporting the good work that that organization does, there's some information in the bulletin, or you can ask Vanessa if you have a question. We're glad to support her and her family and the wonderful work that that alliance does in our community. Let's see, Fab next week and church council meetings noted in our bulletin. You still have an opportunity to sign up to be a lay reader in worship. We still have a few spots in the coming months that we need filled, so I invite you to lend your talents and your voice as a part of leading our worship together. You'll see some dates coming up, our fall family fun, and then our fall festival coming up later in the month. But next Sunday, our family fun is going to be a hiking outing. I think it's a pretty moderate hike, is that fair to say? So put on your good walking shoes, we'll have a picnic lunch, a little hike, and then some ice cream afterwards. So that'll be a fun outing. And finally, you see we're taking orders for new church t-shirts. We have this lovely new church logo, church graphic that's been created for us that incorporates the beauty of our stained glass windows and the idea of our being a tree with deep roots and then fruit that comes from our branches. So we have t-shirts that model that logo, and so you can order those. Information is here in the bulletin, and there is a clipboard where you can order those shirts. Oh, Dana has it. Okay, children's and men's sizes. And there's three colors, so we'll look forward to ordering those and then sporting those as we go out into our community. I'll invite you to join me in our call to worship. Welcome to God's house. We are delighted to have you here.
We hunger for God's word.
You have come to the right place. Here you will be fed on the life-giving love of God.
You thirst for God's healing in our lives.
At the table of the Lord, you will be fed and your thirst quenched.
Thanks be to God, who provides for our needs.
Please stand as you are able and join us singing, Lead On, O Cloud of Presence.
Thank you. kingdoms and translate his wonders into music. Honor his holy name with hallelujahs. You who seek God, live a happy life. Keep your eyes open for God. Watch for his works. Be alert for the signs of his presence. Remember the world of wonders he has made, his miracles, and the verdicts he's rendered. O seed of Abraham, his servant, O child of Jacob, his chosen.
Jesus said, "Let the children come to me and do not hinder them, for to such as these belongs the kingdom of heaven." We remember those words of Jesus and invite all of our young disciples to come up for a special time of sharing with Jean.
Jesus loves the little children, all the children of the world. Black and white, they are precious in his sight. Jesus loves the little children of the world. What made you think of Japan? I do. I'm wearing a kimono robe and I have a Japanese parasol. The Spanish word for umbrella is parasol, and sol in Spanish is sun, and you can use this on a hot, sunny day to shade yourself. Good thinking, Jane. Okay. Today is a special Sunday in the life of the church. And before we talk about that, I want to do some show and tell. Yes, Elise?
Is this special day to
It includes Japan. It includes Japan. It is World Communion Sunday. I brought some things to show and talk to you about. I'm wearing a kimono robe from Japan. This is a bag that my mother-in-law Ginger gave me. I couldn't reach her yesterday. It is from a country either in Central or South America. This is a scarf.
Can you all hear me?
Yeah. Okay. This is a scarf that I bought this summer in Ireland at the farmer's market. And I asked the lady, she said, it's all hand-dyed. Look how soft it is. And I asked her if she made it. And she said, no, but she knows a family in Scotland. And the lady there makes them and she sells them for her because they're good friends. So I'll always remember my Ironman trip when I wear this scarf. Let's see. This is another thing my mother-in-law gave me. It's an apron. It's too pretty. I've never used it. I'll probably turn it into a pillow someday. It's also from Central or South America. What else do I have in here? These. You can feel these too. You can pass them down. Those are sheep. My daughter-in-law, Darcy, went on a trip to Iceland, and she gave me those when she got home. They're made out of wool from real sheep in Iceland. You can hang on to those for a minute. You see these pretty bowls? That's real wool from real sheep in Iceland. Not the whole thing, apart from this beautiful money. Well, it might be felt to go. These were handmade by someone in Africa. I bought these at a market in Zambia, Africa. My daughter lived in Zambia. Do they? Awesome. Wow, you can teach me about that. I don't know. I don't know how they did it. This I bought in the same market from a different booth, and it is a bag made out of African how do I say this? Jitenge cloth. The ladies in Africa wear colored wraps made out of these bright fabrics. So I have that too. Just one or two more things in here. This is a bowl hand painted in Poland. My daughter lived in Belgium for a while, and when I went over to visit her, You can buy these sometimes in the United States, but in Belgium, ladies would have parties in their house and sell these, kind of like we had Tupperware parties in the day here in the States. And lastly, I have a spoon rest, and I keep it by my oven, and I cook with it, and you can tell I use it every day because it's all chipped off. It was made in Mexico. And my daughter-in-law, Darcy, and my son, Stephen, brought me this back from their honeymoon in Mexico. Can you believe they were thinking of me during their honeymoon? Crazy. All right. I brought all these things from all around the world because today is World Communion Sunday. Communion is something Jesus gave us so that we can remember Jesus and remember God's love. And today, almost all Christians everywhere, in any city, in any country, are worshiping on the same day, October 1, 2023, through communion. When we all have communion together, we are reminded that we are united by God's love. All of us, all around the world, wherever we live, the love of Christ brings us together, and everyone is welcome at God's table. That is good news. I like that the way the word communion sounds like it, what it is. Come, union. Communion. Come be together with God. Let's pray. God, thank you for sending Jesus, the bread of life, manna from heaven. Thank you for giving us a way that we can see and touch and taste and smell together this mini meal of communion. Remembering you. Thank you for these signs of your love for us. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. And you can go back to your seat for the children's church. Thank you. Thank you.
Please stand if you're able and join us in One Bread, One Body.
Oh,
spirits to gather in prayer, knowing that God hears us as we call out with prayers of thanksgiving, with prayers of concern, with prayers of intercession for others. You might have prayer requests, joys or concerns that are on your heart and your mind this day, names and circumstances that you want to lift up to God. So we'll have a moment of silence. I invite you to do that, and I will offer prayer for us together. Let us pray. O God of all creation, you are with us on the journey. Like the Israelites in the wilderness, we too have known your love and experienced your care. We trust you to lead us through the parted waters, to guide us with the cloud of your presence, and to feed us with the bread from heaven. When we begin to doubt, when we grumble, you demonstrate to us again your goodness and your faithfulness. You give to us the living water and the bread of life. As we pray together, we lift up prayers for your children who don't have enough, who are hungry and thirsty and who are seeking shelter, who need medical care, who are working to care for their families, who are afraid to ask for help. We lift up your children who are struggling physically, dealing with chronic pain, with life-threatening illness, with memory loss, and who are preparing to transition from this life. We seek the presence of your Holy Spirit, your Spirit of comfort and peace, to abide with each of these, your children, and bring healing and wholeness. As we pray together, we lift up prayers of thanksgiving for all the ways that you have satisfied our souls this week, for the ways that your created world has provided for us with sun, rain, beauty, with the fruit of the harvest, and with rest. We're thankful for the Sabbath day, a day that is set apart for worship, for gathering, for resting in your holy presence. We're grateful for the tables where we have found a seat, found a meal, found a friend. Particularly, we are grateful for this table, God, your table, where we are all invited today. We join the body of Christ around the world in sharing the sacrament, receiving your gift of grace. We pray that it will nourish us so that we can go from here and be your body, your hands, your feet, your heart. Continue to guide and direct us, O God. Equip us to use our talents, our time, our resources, so that we may lead lives that are worthy of our calling. We pray in the name of Jesus, who is the bread of life, and we join our voices together in the prayer that he has taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. As we continue in worship, in addition to worshiping God through our prayers, through our songs, through the sacrament, and through the scripture, we also worship God by giving our gifts, giving our offerings and our tithes, which is returning to God a portion of what God has first gifted to us, trusted to us, and asked us to be good stewards of. We thank you for the ways that you give your gifts faithfully and generously that support ministries of this church that don't just stay here on this campus, but go beyond us into our community and into the world, to ABCCM, to schools, and to Africa University, and to many, many other places to touch hearts and lives and minds and raise up new and young disciples. We'll give our gifts today by passing the offering plates down the pews, and we always can give our gifts online through our church website and in the narthex where there is a box for that purpose. We'll invite the ushers to come. Thank you.
Oh, verses 2 through 15. The whole company of Israel complained against Moses and Aaron there in the wilderness. The Israelites said, "Why didn't God let us die in comfort in Egypt, where we had lamb stew and all the bread we could eat? You brought us out into this wilderness to starve us to death, the whole company of Israel." God said to Moses, "I'm going to rain bread down from the skies for you. The people will go out and gather each day's ration. I'm going to test them to see if they'll live according to my teaching or not. On the sixth day, when they prepare what they have gathered, it will turn out to be twice as much as their daily ration." Moses and Aaron told the people of Israel, "This evening you will know that it is God who brought you out of Egypt, and in the morning you will see the glory of God. Yes, he's listened to your complaints against him. You haven't been complaining against us, you know, but against God." Moses said, "Since it will be God who gives you meat for your meal in the evening and your fill of bread in the morning, it's God who will have listened to your complaints against him. Who are we in all of this? You haven't been complaining to us. You've been complaining to God." Moses instructed Aaron, "Tell the whole company of Israel, come near to God. He's heard your complaints." When Aaron gave out the instructions to the whole company of Israel, they turned to face the wilderness. And there it was, the glory of God visible in the cloud. God spoke to Moses, "I've listened to the complaints of the Israelites. Now tell them, at dusk you will eat meat, and at dawn you'll eat your fill of bread, and you'll realize that I am God, your God." That evening, quail flew in and covered the camp. And in the morning, there was a layer of dew all over the camp. When the layer of dew had lifted, there on the wilderness ground was a fine, flaky something, fine as frost on the ground. The Israelites took one look and said to one another, "Manhu, what is it?" They had no idea what it was. So Moses told them, "It's the bread God has given you to eat." This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
One day a woman walked through the doors of a department store, and to her surprise, as she walked through the doors, a band started to play. And the store manager walked over to her and pinned a beautiful corsage to her shirt, and he handed her a crisp $100 bill. "Congratulations, you're the store's 1 millionth customer." The local news station was on hand to cover the celebration, and they brought a camera crew, and they zoomed in on this woman who was standing there kind of stunned that all of this had developed. And so a reporter began to interview her, and she said, "Tell me, ma'am, just what did you come in here for today?" And the customer hesitated for a minute, and she looked down and she answered kind of sheepishly, "Well, I was on my way to the complaint department." The complaint department. That must be a fun place to work. Is there something in our nature that tempts us to complain? Or is it something that we learn how to do? We start complaining at a young age. We say things like, "Well, I shouldn't have to clean my room. My teacher gives too much homework. All my friends are allowed to go. Why can't I go? Peas for dinner again." But we won't really outgrow that behavior, do we? I wonder if maybe God needs a complaint department. Human beings have certainly bent God's ear throughout all of history. And here we come to Exodus and find the Israelites are no exception. They have a lot to say to God. One translation of this passage says they were murmuring and grumbling. They're complaining to Moses and Aaron, but they're really complaining against God. Why? They were hungry. They were thirsty. They were worried. It's been about a month since that miraculous crossing through the waters that we heard about last week and the start of their wilderness journey. And they will continue to wander through the wilderness for 40 years before they enter the promised land. But they don't know that yet. So they have 1 month down and 479 to go. Here's the map of that long journey that they will take. So they look around as they start this journey and they find this wilderness is dry and dusty and bare. There's no Ingles or Food Lion or Walmart. They don't see any natural resources in the wilderness of Sinai. There's no water source. And that unleavened bread that they had packed for the journey, well, it's run out. There aren't enough animals with them for eating and for sacrificing in worship and for reproducing and sustaining their herds. There's just not enough. So they start to complain. They direct their concerns to Moses and Aaron, their leaders. If only we had died in Egypt, Moses and Aaron. At least in Egypt, we had food to eat. You know, it really wasn't so bad in Egypt. We had food to fill our bellies. We could sit around pots of meat. Oh, it smelled so good. Surely that was better than where we are today. Why have you two brought us out here just so we could starve to death? Their memory was short. How quickly they've forgotten the suffering, the misery, and the danger of Egypt. But when your stomach aches because it's empty, it's hard to think about anything else, isn't it? Readers of the book of Exodus are often quick to criticize the people for this murmuring and grumbling. But how does God respond to these complaints? God says, "I hear you." Four times in this passage, God says, "I have heard. I have heard your concerns, I've heard your worries, I've heard your complaints. And I'm going to answer. I'm going to rain down bread from heaven for you." And God gave them what, quail in the evening and manna in the morning, and it was enough to satisfy their hunger and fill them up. That Hebrew word for manna, maybe you've heard it in the scripture, it literally means, what is it? They looked around in the morning and they saw this flaky, fine substance that was laying on the ground, kind of like, well, in a few weeks we'll see the first frost that lays on the ground. What is it? They asked, and Moses told them, "This is the bread that God has given you to eat. This, it doesn't come in loaves, but this is bread from heaven." And so for the next 479 months, they ate it, manna. They ate raw manna and boiled manna and baked manna and fried manna. Maybe they even got creative. I wonder if they made manna soup or manna casserole every day. It was manna from heaven. And there were rules about how they could gather this manna, right? If we keep reading, they were only allowed to gather as much as they needed for how many days? Just one day. So there was no hoarding allowed. You only got to take what you needed for one day. Now some people hedged their bets and they thought, I'm gonna get more. But then the next day, that extra manna, what had happened to it? It was rotten and crawling with maggots. But there was one exception to that rule. On the sixth day, they gathered twice as much because they weren't going to gather on the seventh day. They had that day off. There was no work of any kind on the Sabbath. That's a day for rest. And what's interesting is that this happens, this day of rest, Moses hasn't gone up on the mountain yet, right, and received the Ten Commandments. That's our scripture for next week. We'll hear about the Ten Commandments. There's no instruction about observing the Sabbath day, but God's already teaching them this, already setting this pattern for how they're going to live. So as they start this long journey, 40-year journey. God's already teaching them about who they are and about whose they are. They're going to remember it was God that brought them out of Egypt, that it was God that delivered them through that water on dry land, and it was God who rained down bread from heaven and fed them. 1 month into what some scholars call their wilderness school, the Israelites learned some important things about their God. One, we don't take more than we need. Two, what we have, it belongs to God. And three, everybody gets enough. God provided enough. Enough food, enough rest to sustain the people. There wasn't any need to race and to grab and to hoard and to store up and worry about tomorrow, because when tomorrow came, the manna was there, just like it was the day before, and the day before, and the day before, just like God said it was going to be. And so when their wilderness wandering comes to an end, they take some of that manna and they keep it in a jar in the Ark of the Covenant next to the tablets of the law, so they remember God's daily provision for them. Is it possible that when Jesus is teaching his disciples how to pray, when he teaches them to pray, give us this day our daily bread, we prayed that earlier in the service, is it possible he had this miracle in mind, this miracle of the manna, when God gives the people their daily bread? The disciples were also learning to trust that God would provide for them. In John chapter 6, Jesus says, "I am the bread that came down from heaven." In Jesus, God has provided in the most generous and surprising way possible. Like the Israelites that maybe were expecting beautiful, buttery loaves of bread instead of, well, something that was sort of like grits. People weren't quite sure what to make of Jesus. He wasn't what they were expecting. But once they got a taste of what Jesus offered, they said, "Give us this bread always." They found that Jesus satisfied every hunger, not just the physical one, but the longings of their hearts. God's miracles usually do surprise us, don't they? And often they take a form that we weren't expecting. When she was 46 years old, Sarah Miles took her first communion, and it was not what she expected. She was a journalist and a self-professed atheist, and she happened to walk through the doors of an Episcopal church on a Sunday morning in San Francisco. She claimed to be a skeptic, and she was there to kind of study and observe the people in the church, but said she actually encountered God there. She says about the service, we all gathered around the table, and there was singing, and there was standing, and someone took a piece of fresh, crumbly bread, and they put it in my hands, and they said, "The body of Christ." And then they handed me the goblet of sweet wine, and they said, "The blood of Christ." And something outrageous and terrifying happened. Jesus happened to me, she said. That hunger inside of her for something extraordinary, something holy, something divine, it sent her back to the same church week after week after week. She would go to the table and she would receive the communion elements, the bread and the wine, and she would start to experience these emotions that she'd never felt before. They seemed to just come out of nowhere, and she found there was tears and there was joy and there was this longing in her. And she said, for a journalist, she just couldn't put it into words. But she was drawn back there Sunday after Sunday after Sunday. So she pulled out a Bible and she started to read it. And any other theological book she could get her hands on. Her mind was hungry too. She started to pray. And she started to find other people and have conversations with them about their faith and about God who they believed in. And she started to feel like there had been this she says, the prerequisite for a religious conversion. It wasn't knowing how to behave in church, and it wasn't knowing all the right religious words or a right set of beliefs. It was actually hunger. It was this hunger that I had always carried. And so after Sarah had been participating in worship in this church for a few years, one day the priest came to her and asked her, "Sarah, would you help serve communion at worship this week?" She said yes, and that was another step in her faith journey. She took the bread, and she put it in other people's hands and said, "This is Jesus given for you." And when she was serving communion, she realized that God was calling her to feed other people. Not just by sharing communion elements, but by sharing groceries with people in the neighborhood that didn't come into their church building and didn't have enough food to eat. So Sarah started a food pantry at her church. And every week they would take groceries to hundreds of their neighbors. And before long, they couldn't feed all of their neighbors through their one food pantry, so Sarah started other food pantries around their city. "This was the work that communion brought me to," she said. "This was the bread of life." She's taken her story and she's written it down in her own memoir. And she says, "Because I was transformed, I was able to be part of the transformation of other people." Mahatma Gandhi once said, "There are people in the world that are so hungry that God cannot appear to them except in the form of bread." Perhaps that's what happened to the people of Israel as they wandered. And maybe that hunger is a physical hunger. Maybe it's a spiritual hunger. Maybe it is a longing of our hearts for what only God can give. Jesus is God's manna in the wilderness. He is the one that gives us what we need, though maybe not always what we want. Through Jesus, God gives us life, breath, bread, juice, and God's very self. Today, we get to come to God's table. We're invited, all of us, to receive that gift that God has given, to give thanks for the bread of life that is Jesus. We then leave this table and we go into the world to be the body of Christ for the world and know that God is with us wherever we might go. Did you know what the very first food to be eaten and the first liquid to be poured on the moon are? I learned this week. It was communion bread and wine. On July 20th, 1969, Apollo 11 became the first crewed mission that landed on the moon. And after they landed safely, they had this kind of long waiting period with several hours so the astronauts could kind of recover from their space journey and get ready for that history-making moonwalk that they would take. And so Buzz Aldrin, who was an elder at his Presbyterian church in Texas, had received special permission to take the consecrated elements, bread and wine, with him on his journey to the moon and partake of them there. So during that waiting period, he took the opportunity to ask for a few moments of silence. And then he reached for the bread that he had packed for the journey and the wine. He said, "I poured the wine into the chalice that our church had given me to take." And he said, "And in the reduced gravity of the moon, it kind of curled slowly and gradually came up the side of that chalice." And so there, as he waited on the moon, he ate the bread, he drank the wine, he read scripture. There it is, written out in his handwriting. And so his intent in having this moment of worship was to give thanks. He gave thanks for all the work and the dedication that had made this journey possible. He says, I was aware that this was the culmination of 300,000 or 400,000 people over a decade, hopes and dreams and hard work.
And so he gave thanks for all of those people and for their gifts and safety. And I wonder if another aspect of that was he recognized God's magnificent creation. He certainly had a unique view of it, one that not many of us get to have. And so I wonder if he felt like the crew of Apollo 8, you know, that read the Genesis 1 text in their Christmas broadcast. And I wonder if Aldrin also realized he was sort of entering this new wilderness. He was setting foot where no other human being had ever set foot before. And I wonder if he had this awareness that even then there is no place we can go where God is not. So he ate the bread and he drank the wine, and he knew that even 240,000 miles from home, that God was with him. How and when have you experienced that assurance? Where have you found your manna from heaven? We didn't go out into our front yards this morning and collect manna, right? But perhaps other things have been manna. Perhaps it was the sun that rose, or the hot cup of coffee that started our day, or a prayer that was simply, "Thank you, God, for waking me up this morning." Maybe that was manna. Maybe it was a phone call from someone who called to check on you and said, "I'm thinking of you, I'm praying for you, I love you." That's manna. Maybe it was a song, a prayer, a devotion. Maybe a loved one or a friend or the dog climbed into your lap and made you smile. That's manna. This week we received some sweet notes and cards in the mail from some young disciples, and that brought great joy, and that was manna. See, the miracle of manna is not the thing itself, but it's the one that sends it. So in that way, anything can be manna. So keep your eyes open this week, because you will find manna in many different places. Now we'll start with some bread and some juice that is manna. We come to God's table, we join, as Jean told us, Christian brothers and sisters all around the world accept the same invitation to the same table and know that we are one in God. I invite you to follow our liturgy as we prepare to come to the table. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right
and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. You have made from one every nation and people to live on all the face of the earth. So with all your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and we join their unending hymn saying, "Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest."
Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. He commissioned us to be his witnesses to the ends of the earth, and to make disciples of all nations. And today, his family and all the world is joining at his holy table. On the night that he gave himself up for us, Jesus took bread. He gave thanks to you, and he broke the bread. He gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, Jesus took the cup, gave thanks to you, and gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant. It is poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins.
And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us, as together we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ is died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here, on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and the blood of Christ, so that we can be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. Renew our communion with your church throughout the world, and strengthen it in every nation and among every people to witness faithfully in your name. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory, and we all feast together at his heavenly banquet table. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. This is God's table, and all are invited to come and to receive the gift of grace. When the ushers direct you, you'll be invited to come forward and to receive a piece of bread and a pre-filled cup of juice, which is glass. So after you've eaten and after you drink your juice, you can return your cups to the tubs that are there at the end of the altar rails. We invite you, if you feel a desire to kneel at the altar rail in a time of prayer, if you prefer to remain in your seat and to receive the elements there, the ushers have some pre-packaged wafers and juice, and so just let them know and they will offer that to you. And the gift of grace is the same, so you're welcome to receive just where you are. We'll invite those who are serving to come forward.
Please stand as you're able to join us singing our closing hymn, "What Peace of Love."
We've been nourished at God's table, and we are so grateful for this beautiful altarscape. Thank you to Glenda and Kaylee for making that possible. We invite you to take some of that with you. It's been donated. We don't want it to go to waste, so after the benediction, some of our worship stewards will be here to bag that up for you. You can take some of the bread of heaven home with you. You can taste and see that the Lord is good. Go in that peace.